I think it's something that everyone is aware of, but it's kind of in the background most of the time, and you don't really know who these children are because typically they're from, you know, poor families. And there's a tendency, I think, across the world to ignore people from certain communities. I mean, it's very easy to convince yourself that their problem is actually not your problem and they don't deserve your attention.
Hello and welcome back to the Vintage Podcast with me, Leena Norms. New year, new decade, and definitely some incredible new debut authors. In today's episode, we're going to be meeting two of them, Anne Yu, who is the author of Braised Pork, and Deepa, who is the author of Djinn Patrol on the Purple Line. First off, I'd love you to meet Anne Yu. Her book follows a main character who one morning after breakfast walks into her bathroom to find her husband dead in their bathtub. From there, we watch her life in Beijing change beyond recognition, haunted by the sketch of a strange creature from her husband's dream. This kind of half fish, half man. It's got folklore, it's got travel, it's got adventure, it's got romance. It's an incredible book, and I'm really excited for you to hear more about it. So here's my little chat with Anne Yu. Anne Yu, thank you so much for joining us on the Vintage Podcast. How are you today?
Good.
How
are you?
I'm not too bad. I'm better for having read your book. Tell us a little bit about the idea for Braised Pork. Like, how did it come about? Did it start as a short story? How did it...
It sort of did. I've been wanting to write the story of Jia Jia for maybe a few months before I started the novel. And I was writing bits and pieces of it as a short story. And then the idea of sort of the fish man came to me in a dream.
Really?
Yeah.
Because that's for those of people who haven't read the book yet, that's how it comes to the main character.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It comes almost exactly like how it came to her husband. So that dream is 80% real.
Yeah.
And then I wanted to write that into a short story as well. And then I had the story on my mind, so I tried to combine the two, and then I soon realized that it was a much bigger piece.
What I think is really interesting is it's obviously set in modern China, and it's about, well, I'm not going to say what it's about, but for me, one of the things that came out of it for me was a modern woman trying to find her way in the world, especially as a widow. How do you think weaving folklore in with that, was that like a conscious choice to weave in this kind of old folklore with this new landscape of...
I've never thought about her being a widow connecting into folklore,
but
there is this idea of navigating a modern city that is somewhat really strange and eerie, of an experience. And I think the best way for me to tell that story is through something a bit more magical and a bit more dreamy, like folklore. So that's sort of where it came from, because I couldn't really find a better or another way of encapsulating that experience.
Yeah. How did you go about formulating all the characters? Because they're so vivid and she meets so many people along the way. It's kind of like a bit of an odyssey. So she goes on this trip and all these characters keep coming in and out of her life. How are they based on real people, or are they like, you know?
I think they're all based on real people, parts of real people. And I wouldn't say that one character is entirely sort of exists in real life, but they do have, I think the moments that are based on real life are the small moments, like how their hands move, maybe one or two words they say, and it's just in these tiny moments that are the most telling in terms of characterization. I think those very much come from real life experiences.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about your choice to write it, obviously in English, because you know Beijing so intimately. Again, like kind of studying in a Western setting, do you think there are misconceptions people have about China? And how? What was your decision to kind of write it in English and see it from that perspective?
I started writing the short story in English just because at the time I felt comfortable in writing it in English more so than in Chinese, just because it was a good exercise. And being in the NYU setting, sort of everything had to be in English anyway. But it worked out really, really well because it helps me sort of focus my attention on what the core of the story is and what actually matters in the story, rather than going off on tangents that are like very specific to sort of Chinese culture that would be hard to even translate to like a more sort of universal audience. And it that kind of stuff I don't think really needs to be in the novel. I sort of like it as a novel that's sort of stripped down to just to very simple and just sort of clean emotional experiences.
Do you have any tips for people who want to get into writing, like things you wish you'd known before you'd started the book, or that kind of thing? Or something unexpected about the writing process as well? Because it must be strange having the book out now and people reading it, you're like, what are you talking about my characters?
Just how, I think how personal writing is, just to be aware of that, and how, like, even if you try to mask yourself behind all these characters and the plot and whatever, it becomes something so personally about yourself, at least for me, that you really have to feel comfortable with displaying that to a reader. But it's also at the same time so rewarding and such a lovely experience just to know that the reader might be able to understand a part of you and make you sort of feel like you're being heard in a certain way. So
that makes sense.
Yeah. And also discipline.
Yeah. Actually getting to the end is the part that matters. Yeah. Do you see yourself in the main character at all? When you say that, you see, like, what parts of you do you think might have been exposed? Or if you're like, I'm not going to tell you if you haven't noticed.
I think almost every part. She has, in terms of her sort of her life experience, she has nothing, there's nothing that resembles me. But a lot of, I guess, emotional responses to certain things, and I don't know, subconsciously, my friends all say that they see parts of me in her, so...
Oh, really?
So I trust they've them noticed. More than I trust myself by now. So.
Yeah. Like, the role of water in the book is is really interesting as well. Was that something that... Was it there from the beginning, or is that something that,
that
kind of...
was there from the beginning.
Yeah.
Water has been something that's weirdly been in and around my life since I was a child. The aquarium incident was a real incident, too, and just... There's been a lot... And we used to have all these floods at home. It's just been something that's been a sort of a recurring thing growing up. And I've always, just like Dadia, I guess, I've been very, very interested in, like, the properties of water and sort of how violent it can be, but also serene. And just there's so much...
Yeah, because it's such a thing that kind of it sustains you, but also there's this fear throughout the book of being swallowed by water, by going to a place of water and not being able to come back. Mm-hmm. And that's...
So as an image, it came to me quite obviously and quite quickly. So I wanted that to be a big part of the novel. So that was the plan.
That was Anu, and she is the author of Braised Pork. I really hope you pick up a copy. It's really, really excellent. The next author we have to introduce you to is Deepa. As I said, she is the author of Djinn Patrol on the Purple Line. Deepa spent 11 years working as a journalist in South India, reporting on the ways poverty and religious violence impact children's education. The story follows 9-year-old Jay, who follows far too many reality TV police shows, and when his friend from school goes missing, decides to use his crime-solving skills to go on an adventure and find out where he might have gone. The book is absolutely brimming with character and personality, and I was so excited to talk to Deepa about how she wrote it. Deepa, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. How are you today?
I'm fine. Thank you for having me.
No problem. So you've written such a wonderful book, and I know that people are already really excited to have it on the shelves. Because of your incredible kind of journalistic background, what do you think do you bring from that journalistic head into your writing? When you were planning the book, were you very methodical about it? Did you do a lot of research about the kind of real life equivalent characters? And
I think that's definitely one thing from my journalistic background, is that I like doing research. I do quite a lot of research before I actually start writing anything. I don't know if that's good or bad. I'm still figuring it out. But that's definitely from my background, I think. And I do, you know, I speak to people. I try to travel to those areas again. I speak to charities that are working in that sector, for instance, mm-hmm. or experts related to the subject that I'm writing about. So all that definitely comes from my background as a reporter. When I started writing fiction, I think, which was about 10 years ago, I really had to tell myself to stop being a journalist, you know, which is quite hard as well, because I was so, it was, I think I come from that school of journalism where facts are considered sacred. And for me to learn how to let my imagination have a role in what I wrote was, it was a big change. And I had to essentially teach myself to do that as well.
Yeah, I can imagine someone had to beat down the journalist inside of you a little bit and be like, shut up, I'm trying to create.
And, you know, so I really had to tell myself it's okay, like, this doesn't have to be real. And these characters can behave in whichever way you want to. And, you know, that was just a huge change.
Yeah, and I guess it's an interesting choice as well that you kind of choose to talk about these children's stories from a first person perspective, which makes you partial and like that you're trained to be impartial, so pulling yourself into that and really being on the side of the kids is really amazing.
I think that was really one of the biggest differences in my journalism, because, you know, we were taught to write in a balanced, objective fashion without taking anyone's side. So in fiction, you have to really inhabit a character fully and show everything from their perspective as how they view the world, which is quite different for me. Yeah,
definitely. Tell us a little bit about, you know, kind of a lot of these news stories that we read about and how that kind of inspired the book. So it's 180 kids every day in India go missing, and they're very rarely investigated.
There are no clear figures as to how many children go missing. So this is the reality, that nobody actually knows how many children go missing in India, because the police may not report many of the cases. Sometimes parents may not go up to the police to complain because they're afraid of the police. So actually nobody really knows. This figure was one which was put out by a charity that works with children a couple of years ago, and they said that 180 children go missing each day, and the number could be higher or lower. And it is definitely an issue, and I think it's something that everyone is aware of, but it's kind of in the background most of the time, and you don't really know who these children are, because typically they're from, you know, poor families. And there's a tendency, I think, across the world to ignore people from certain communities. I mean, it's very easy to convince yourself that their problem is actually not your problem and they don't deserve your attention. So this happens everywhere, and it's the same in India as well. So I mean, when I was working as a reporter, I would come across these stories of children disappearing, but nobody actually, you know, you couldn't really, they were just sort of amorphous shapes. You didn't know who they were. You had no idea what they wanted to do with their lives. So essentially you can reduce people to numbers and you don't know who they are behind those numbers. You don't know their faces. And that is definitely one of the reasons why I wanted to write this book, because, you know, I wanted to bring them to the fore and tell the story from the children's point of view.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I suppose that tendency to make facts anonymous can transfer into humans. And once we make humans anonymous, that's when we stop caring or stop investigating. Tell us a little bit about one of the main characters, Jay, who kind of seems to take over the story a lot. Yeah. And even though obviously we do hear from other perspectives, tell us how you kind of brought him from the shadows and made him this one person. Because what I love about him is that he's so distinctive and he has a very distinctive voice. It's often quite humorous, and his perspective brings a lot of humour to what's quite a dark story. Yeah. Tell us about how you invented him or discovered him, or however you want to phrase it.
He is really a composite of the children that I had interviewed when I was working as a reporter. Mm-hmm. So at that time, I used to write on education. It was my beat. And I had to talk to children who are either in, you know, government schools or out of school because of difficult domestic or financial circumstances to find out, you know, why they weren't in school. And I was essentially investigating how government policy was being implemented on the ground, especially when it came to children. So this meant that I had to interview a lot of children to find out what they were doing, how they were doing. And one of the things that always struck me was, you know, how funny and sarcastic these children could be, and despite their circumstances, not to romanticize poverty in any way, because obviously it is a very difficult life, and you know, there's no looking away from that. But they're not defined by just like anyone else. You're not defined just by whatever your problems are. And so I really wanted to capture that kind of, you know, swagger and their humor. Yeah. And in how I wrote, because it's something I couldn't do in my reports, because I was writing within those very strict word counts and tight deadlines. So you had to strip it off all sorts of extraneous detail, like how the children actually were. And I think I brought all of that, which I didn't include in my reports, into this character who's essentially a composite of, you know, many of the children I'd interviewed, and also the children I know in my life, like my nephews.
Yeah, that's lovely. So they kind of, a little element of all of them is in him. There's a potentially for people, I kind of learned a little bit about it when I was a kid, but tell us a little bit about the tradition of djinns and what they are and how, because they're different from ghosts. Tell us a little bit about what a djinn is and how they appear in the story.
I don't want to pretend to be an expert, first of all, because I think it's such a complicated subject, and people have literally written books about it. But ghosts are essentially human beings who've died and who reappear in some form to you. And
Shadows of reality.
Whereas djinns are meant to be spirits, and the belief is that they're created from smokeless fire. They can be good or bad, and they can take on the form of a human or an animal. And these are spirits that are worshipped across India, I think the Middle East, and, you know, many Asian countries. So it's, I think, we share djinns with, you know, our neighboring countries, for instance. There's similar kind of belief in djinns as well. So especially in the north of India, there are places where djinns are meant to reside. So, for instance, there's a place in Delhi where people believe that good djinns live, and you can visit them and you can pray to them and they'll grant you their wishes. So djinns are essentially the... I mean, it's from djinns that, you know, genies come from djinns.
I literally never made that connection.
It's an Americanized, the Hollywood version of djinn is the genie, whereas the genie is sort of a much more, I think it's a character that Hollywood has made everybody familiar with.
And the genie serves someone.
Yeah, they do.
It sounds like the djinns in your book.
No, they're serve not. No one. So that is essentially the difference, that... genie is sort of like a wish granter creature, isn't it? Yeah, but whereas a djinn is much more, you would be scared of a djinn, I think.
Yeah.
That's essentially how people view them.
And also the myths, there's three myths that kind of come up in the book. How did you pick which ones to include? And were they things that you grew up with as well?
Yeah, I mean, there are stories of djinns and spirits. In fact, in every city I lived in, because I moved around India quite a fair bit, and, you know, in every city there'll be an area, there'll be a story about a ghost, or an area where people say, okay, a ghost is, you know, spotted here in her white sari after midnight. So it's quite common, and so it didn't seem unnatural to me to include those stories. And also within that, it's within that larger framework of these stories that, you know, the characters in my book live. I mean, this is a world that they inhabit, they believe in these stories, and I wanted to include them because it's their situation is quite difficult, and no one is essentially helping them, you know. The institutions that you turn to in terms of crisis, like the police or the government, they've just abdicated that responsibility towards them, and they have nowhere else to turn to. So it's, I think, part of the reason why that belief in the supernatural is so strong, because, you know, you're feeling abandoned otherwise. And so these are stories, the characters over here, or, you know, it's just something people believe in. And they're turning to these stories for sort of some sort of comfort. And I really wanted to explore how these stories can offer some solace, but also may not, you know, in some cases.
Yeah, yes. They're not enough.
Yeah, they're not enough. Because I think there is the idea that a story can solve everything, but the reality can be quite different.
When you kind of made the choice to put so much humor in the books, that's what it was really interesting, because I think it's such a book of light and dark. There's rarely those moments where you give us the bit in the middle. It's like so, it's this beautiful juxtaposition. Why was it important for you to include the kind of humor in the book and those kind of things?
Yeah, I don't think I made a conscious decision about, you know, how the character should sound. I think it came from Jay, because he's a funny kid. He sees things. He has this very unique take on the world, which, you know, no one else may agree with at all. Yeah. But that's his point of view. And so once I started writing him, so for instance, it was by writing the first paragraph in his voice that I knew that, right, this is a kid who believes in djinns, because I didn't know that until I started writing it.
Yeah.
And so essentially it was, you know, just by writing him that I understood how he looked at the world. And again, also staying true to the kind of kids that I had interviewed and how they used to be quite funny. And even these situations, because I think there might be a tendency to think that if you're going through a difficult time or if your situation is quite difficult, then you can't be humorous, you can't find anything funny. But in a way, that's almost like denying someone their humanity. And I just wanted to be sure that I didn't write anyone that way, that I didn't make anyone look as if, you know, they're just the sum of their problems. You know, everybody is much more than that. And I felt that, definitely felt that responsibility towards portraying characters in that way. And humor was definitely one way of achieving that. And I knew that, you know, it is a dark story. It's about disappearances of children. But in everyone's life, there are moments of light, and I wanted to be sure I captured that as well. But mostly it came from Jay and, you know, his view of the world.
Thank you so much for listening to the Vintage Podcast. That was Deepa, author of Djinn Patrol on the Purple Line. Thank you as well to Anne Yu, author of Braised Pork, for chatting to us today. I hope those two interviews gave you an idea of some new debut authors to pick up in 2020. Thank you so much for listening to the Vintage Podcast. Do come over and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Vintage Books. Our last episode was dispelling some myths and exploring poetry, so do go back and listen to that. I've been Leena Norms, and until next time.